BSO music director Andris Nelsons and Boston Pops conductor Keith Lockhart. They joined us to talk about their friendship, their histories with Tanglewood, and performances ahead. Andris and Keith, it's great to see you.
Hi, great to see you guys.
Thanks for being here.
But you know, apparently it's weird to see you both together because there was kind of a kerfuffle when you guys arrived. Well, I mean, are you sitting next to each other very often? Do you see each other very often?
Conductors don't end up in the same place at the same time very often because there's usually one per concert. So,
you know who he is, right? Okay, I just want to be clear.
We had a lovely dinner on Newberry Street a few months ago.
Yeah.
You know, it's nice to do that every now and then, but it's really true because he's off somewhere else. When the BSO is in session, I'm usually off somewhere else doing something else.
So. You know, I know, I'm 90% sure you both met here at Tanglewood. But before,
I don't remember our first date. Do you?
Well, before we discuss your first date, when did you first hear of Keith Lockhart, Andris?
Well, I first saw and hear as a young, very, very young conductor, and I saw this VHS cassette from the. There was a selection from Boston Pop, and it was, I think, your first year as a music director of Boston Pop, and I was. And that was the first time.
And what do you think of him?
Oh, he's wonderful. I mean, as I always told
he's the nice way of saying I'm a lot older than he is. Well, I should tell you the first time.
I was going to ask. Yes. What is it?
Well, because Andris has been, he's been a big rising star on the classical music scene for, he just turned 40. So, you know, the last 15 years or so, people have been hearing a lot about him. And I have friends, colleagues in London. I have a BBC orchestra over there who worked with him on a regular basis. And I said, you know, so great. He's another person who everybody's talking about. Is he any good? And they said, yeah. My first impression was that the orchestra really wants to play for him. And the number one, number two, and number three things a conductor has to have is people who want to make music with you. If you make people want to make music, you'll make great music. This is just a mutual admiration.
But, you know, we've asked you about that before. I'm not sure we've ever asked you that of you, Keith Lockhart. How you do get new musicians to respond to you?
I think it's leadership. It's the melange of things that make for good leadership, no matter what sort of field you're being a leader in. It's the ability to inspire. It's the ability to criticize at the same time. It's not just being the nicest guy there. It's the one who. But at the end of the day, I think all of us on that stage are professionals and perfectionists, and I think the person who at the end of the day causes the orchestra to collectively reach its highest level of achievement is the person they'd like to see back there. And that was very clear from the beginning with Andris that was how they felt about him.
I want you to ask him that question. What's going to happen when you ask Andris? He's going to put his head in his hands like this and say, no, I don't want to. They don't respond. It's them. But they do respond.
They do.
We've seen it scores of times. What makes the connection that Marjorie was talking about?
Well, when I judge and look the great conductors, one is Keith.
Then
I always
analyze. Don't say any nice things about me anymore.
I mean, I really think it's from one side there is something mystic about that. From one side, from the other side, as Keith thought, actually these qualities what he just named is very, very much true. But I think there's what I find because I am not a conductor type person, and you know, and I'm quite shy, and I don't know. Normally, I would rather hide in a corner and listen. So I have no reason to become a conductor because I want to be in front and I want to lead. You know,
it's not a power trip.
It's not a power at all. It's just that when you are in front of these musicians, you are dealing with the music in such a different way. It's almost like painting, and from the other side, this painting is already painted, but you have an opportunity to encourage to recreate.
You have said often in the last few years when I've had an opportunity to speak to you, Andris, about how even more important music is in frightening times like these. What is it about music in times like this when there is fear and stress and anxiety that makes it even more important than in normal times?
These days we have an endless series of these kinds of moments. I think that maybe being shaken out of our routine by something that horrible may open us up to listening to the deeper messages. It may make us better listeners.
Unfortunately, we are not learning from the history. Somehow the cycles are coming back and and coming back and make even more complicated situations. But I think when we face such a difficult times, for example, when I lived in Soviet Union or my parents lived in a very, very difficult situations, the music, it's like a salvation, it's like a comfort, mm-hmm. you know, because literally you have nothing else, besides your family, but also your family are not able to tell you what they would love to tell you in those difficult times. So you listen to the music and there is no text, there is just a music which touches your heart and you feel comforted.
Yeah, and it's a reminder that there still is true beauty in the world at points that it's really hard to see.
You know, I wonder, when you guys play in Boston, Symphony Hall, right on Mass Avenue, right in the middle of Boston, the traffic and all that, is it different for you? And it must be different for the audience to be here.
Well, the sound of sirens is replaced by the sound of birds. But the bird sound is much more pleasant.
Yeah.
Well, I think in terms of, not so much in performance, but just in terms of your ability to think about music without distractions. I mean, there's a reason that Mahler escaped to the countryside every summer. He didn't escape to the middle of the city.
Whenever I come here, it's from the first moment, you know, you come in on the stage and you have the orchestra and you have this nature and you have the fresh air and you just start to feel like you're part of nature, you know. I don't know, it helps you to perform even better, to the new ideas come because so much, of course, is thought. I mean, the composers, most of them have influence from the nature or use the nature as a metaphor, or whether it's Beethoven or Mahler or John Williams. I think it's the nature is a big inspiration, and I think it's not only for composers but actually also for the performers. It's just like a oxygen, constant oxygen here, and you have the music and you can breathe and everything. So it's just almost like a perfect world, and it's really unique.
And by the way, speaking of our illustrious colleague John Williams, he'll tell you himself that he does some of his best composition here.
Is that really
so? Really, he's writing
big chunks of the summer just to write.
He does.
Does this ever get old for you? You've been doing this for a bit.
I'll let you know when it does. No, I mean, there's always, I mean, obviously in any pursuit, some things get old and some things you're like, oh, that again. But, you know, every time you turn around, there's a new challenge, there's new music to be made, and there's a new audience to reach. And I think that is what keeps a conductor going. You never get there. You never know it all. And that keeps you really honest, and also for lazy people like me, keeps you getting up in the morning.
So can we talk, when you're not on the stage, you know, we all know that you spend most of the summer terrorizing people driving around in a golf cart. We've read that. You still don't know how to drive, is that right?
Yeah. Well,
are you ever going to learn how to drive or no?
I want to do that, but
that's not happening,
it's
right?
It's not happening.
Right? Okay.
I have wonderful, Pepino, the wonderful driver.
The guy who drives, he's wonderful.
But
everybody we encounter.
I'll give you a lift. I can drive.
Every time I come to Tanglewood or talk to anybody that's been here, I said, do you ever see Andris on the grounds? And they talk about you driving at breakneck speed in a golf cart. Is that's you, yes?
Probably. That is,
what is it with you in the golf cart? What do you think the attraction is? Why is it?
He can drive it without a license.
I guess that is what they insure you, yes? They're insured?
Yeah, I think
okay,
so.
Okay, fine. And what do you do when you're not, what do you do for fun out here?
Well, you know, again, I mean, when I am out here, a couple of restaurants I like, I usually take a hike, go up Monument Mountain in Great Barrington or something like that, and I've done that a lot over the last, because I have been here a decent chunk of time if you add up all 25 years, and sometimes for longer chunks at a time. But generally in the summer, the Pops keeps pretty busy in other places, and And my wife and I have a place on the Cape, so we escape kind of in the opposite direction. We escape more toward the water and less toward the mountains.
So to sum it up, when you're here in the summer, you're hiking up mountains and you're terrorizing your listeners in a golf cart. Is that a fair summary of where we are?
Mountains to stay out of the way of him in the golf cart.
Good move.
Keith and Andris, it's great to see you. Thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Welcome to Tanglewood. Yeah.